students, welcome to the series on fundamentals of entrepreneurship. Today we are going to study the behavior of an entrepreneur. Now the behavior of an entrepreneur is designed by the emotional intelligence, the work values, the teamwork and the perceptions. Behavior is important because this is the basic thing which gives success to the entrepreneur in the business. In business sense, we do have the abilities in terms of intelligence, but now emotional maturity has also become important. Research shows that the EQ is 2 times as important as the cognitive abilities of any entrepreneur. It is almost 90% of the success in leadership or in business is due to EQ. The definition of emotional intelligence or the emotional quotient is as follows. Individuals differ from one another in the ability to understand complex ideas, to adapt effectively to the environment, to learn from experience, to engage in various forms of reasoning, to overcome obstacles by taking thought. Now, this is the definition of emotional quotient. The emotional quotient is divided into 2 dimensions. First is the social competency and the personal competency. Now, when you talk about the personal competency, it is again divided into 3 parts. That is the self-awareness, self-management and motivation. The social competency is divided into 2 parts, that is empathy and social skills. Now let's first see what is personal competency. As personal competency is designed by awareness and management and motivation, so it's important to study self-awareness. The concept of self is important for any person, individual or an entrepreneur, because your personal strength estimation is one part which can be expressed as an important force to take business into different directions. Now, self-awareness is also your own emotional awareness and a kind of an accurate assessment of yourself. It is your self-confidence and a kind of a level which you genuinely define yourself in terms of your creativity and your ability to take up the task in a different direction. The self-management is important because if you are not able to manage your emotions in terms of your control power, then you will not be able to build up a kind of awareness, or you are not able to build a kind of ability. Self-control is important because it builds up the trust, it builds up the kind of an ability in terms of adaptability to the situation. This adaptability to the situation can lead to the innovation and to the creativity, where you need to express in form of formations of products and ideas to the society and to the market. When you talk about motivation, a kind of enthusiasm and morale is important, because this enthusiasm is a kind of commitment which gives an ideal shape to the business. Your initiative and a positive thinking and a kind of optimism is important to build up the motivational levels for yourself and your personality and your employees to give a different shape to the organization. Now let's see what the social competency. Social competency is the ability of the skills which you acquire to build an interpersonal kind of relationships with the people. First is empathy. Now what is empathy? The basic meaning of empathy is that you put your feet in somebody else's shoes and then recognize what could be the pains and the pleasures the other person feels. It is understanding others. It is kind of defining themselves in a form where they express in their own formations as individuals. So developing others is an important part of your team and your business. Service orientation towards employees is important, because if you care about your employees, if you care about your people and if you care about your team, you will be a success. You have to leverage diversity. Diversity could be in form of language, in form of culture, in form of abilities, in form of sex, gender, whatever it is. But the diversity has to be leveraged. The innovator or an entrepreneur has to definitely recognize these kinds of differences and acknowledge these differences and simulate them in such a way that they give a shape to the business. The political awareness is important because once you understand the environment in terms of politics, you have to be empathetic to people, you have to respect their political philosophies, and you have to build up the social skills in terms of respect. I mean, you have to have a behavior which you want for yourself. Do to others as you would want them to do to you. When you talk about social competency, your social skills are important. Now, what's social skills? It is an ability to influence people. It is an ability to communicate in such a way that people are impressed by you or people start trusting you. If you have these abilities, they would genuinely buy your products and ideas. You need to have an ability to do a conflict management, because wherever you are staying in the organization, whether it is the customers or the employees, there will always be a kind of a conflict. So the conflict should not be taken to the negative aspect, but it has to be managed in such a way that it gives positive results to the business. Leadership is important, because if you're a person of social importance, your ability to influence will give you a shape and a status in the society where you are or you're recognized as a leader. Then try to become a change catalyst. Change catalyst is a person who has kind of a skill where he changes people's perceptions and his levels of ideas to rhythmize or to synchronize with your own ideas. And you work in a team in such a way that people respect your own beliefs and your own perceptions. Try to build bonds with people and try to collaborate, because the more you collaborate with the people, the more important it is important for your business. Team capabilities are important, because it is individuals cannot do everything and each individual in himself is not complete. You need the abilities from other people also. You need their skills, you need their desires, you need their passions to build up your own empires. So it is important for you as an innovator and an entrepreneur to take up these abilities and design the fabric of success for your business. Now see this emotional intelligence map. Here we have these kind of parameters which are defined in such a way. You have self-awareness, self-management, motivation, empathy, social skills, and building bonds. Bonds are built by the collaborations and the team abilities. How it is important that you build up your emotional quotient, and what could be the strategies to shape up your emotional quotient. First is you try to make a kind of a emotional inventory. Inventory is try to list the qualities of your emotional maturity. Then try to analyze the setting of these skills and try to identify these skills which are needed to promote you as a businessman. Try to enlist the trusted friends you have. Whatever relationships you have, whatever kind of social acknowledgements you have, try to bring up a list and see how many friends you have. Focus on new competency. Whatever is missing in the inventory of the list is try to build up on that area. Then try to practice it. Practice, patience and practice will make you a person in terms of social competency. Try to be observant that where people are not willing to cooperate with you, what could be the missing ideas? Or what could be the things which are making you not aware of being adaptable to people's perceptions. Don't try to expect immediate results. It is a kind of a habit which has to be cultivated, and it will take time, because building relationships needs a lot of trust and needs a lot of empathy. Learn from your mistakes. Wherever you have broken your relationship or wherever you have fought with people, try to take these fights and try to analyze why these things happened, and try to acknowledge whatever you have done wrong. Go and say sorry to people and try to rectify the mistakes, because in time, if you try to stitch those broken relations, it will be a long-term success for your business, because people are important. It is only people who appreciate value. It is people who will build up your empires. So try to give importance to people. Now there are basic 9 strategies by which you could build up your emotional intelligence. First is take time for mindfulness. Recognize and try to name each and every emotions. Try to understand the causes and the feelings of whatever emotions you face. Differentiate between emotion and the need to take action. Prevent depression through learned optimism. Manage anger through learned behavior. Learning the lessons of feelings is important. Use gut feelings in your decision making. Then develop listening skills. These are the basic 9 strategies by which you can shape your EQ, and it is important for your personality as a businessman to promote the feelings of your empathy towards people. Now, the instruments of emotional intelligence are: first is take time, recognize and name people, because if you remember the names of people, they will feel important. It is the causes of the feelings in the people and the causes of feelings in your own personality are important. They have to be recognized and they have to be acknowledged. Differentiate having the emotion of doing something. Learn optimism. Learn to distract the techniques in terms of shaping the behavior. And try to voice your expressions. Try to give a kind of a shape to your expressions and develop the skills of listening. This is all about emotional intelligence. Now, apart from emotional quotient or emotional intelligence or emotional maturity, we also have a concept of intelligence for the entrepreneur. Now, what is intelligence? Intelligence is your analytical reasoning, your verbal skills, your kind of an ability to give attention, your memory ability and your judgmental ability. This also builds up your basic abilities in terms of your behavior of the employee or as an innovator. Now, IQ is not so important for the business because this is a concept which gives a 15% success or a 15% impact in the business. But your EQ is much greater and of much higher level and of much higher importance than IQ. So when you try to develop the IQ, it is important that your abilities in terms of reading and your analytical abilities have to be designed and have to be developed. IQ is developed at the initial stages of life when you go for training in the institutes and all. But the EQ is learnt by your abilities to interact with people. Here the family institution and the social institution in terms of your friends and relatives will put up more impact on building up this EQ. Now, when you talk about EQ, it is a kind of a empathy or it is a kind of a understanding with the society. The greater is the emotional quotient, greater is the stability to your personality, and it is your greater interpersonal sensitivity which gives an fillip and importance to the business. Now, EQ differs between male and female. There are gender differences, like the man or the masculine part of the personality has less EQ, whereas females have a higher level of EQ because they are more emotionally matured. Now let's see what are the differences. Men, they are more willing to compromise social connections for the kind of independence. Like they want independence, economic freedom, or the kind of expression in terms of the achievement. So in that race, they would compromise for family or they would compromise for social connections. Now they are not as good as women. They are less adaptable and they are more physiologically overwhelmed by the marital conflict. But when you talk about women, she is more connected to the society. She has a wider range of emotions. She is better at reading people and she is better at developing social skills. She is more sacrificing in terms of social aspects because she could sacrifice anything to build up a relationship, whether it is a relationship with the husband or the child or parents or even in the organizations. This kind of feminine approach towards the work puts them at a higher level of success. Art of social relationships or managing emotions is one aspect which the entrepreneurs have to study deeply and have to be trained in that. First is to excel at people's skills, means and using the competencies to be an effective friend, a negotiator, a leader. One should be able to guide an interaction, inspire others, make others comfortable in social situations, and influence and persuade others. If you have this ability, you are a successful entrepreneur. What could be the subtle or the underlying abilities which you need to understand from people? First is try to attune yourself to the attitudes and the emotions of the other people. Promote comfort in social situations. Use your own emotional display to show people that you need them more than they need you. The development of emotional intelligence could be a kind of a genetic concept which is heredity. Heredity, like most of the people are very comfortable and social people. They like to interact with people. they are the kind of people like who are extrovert. Then they are kind of people who are generally believe that destiny is important, and these people will be important parts of building up their destiny. Early expressions of people with the good family atmosphere, it is love and affection from your parents, which builds up the EQ. If you have been harassed in your childhood days, then it is very difficult that you built up kind of EQ. Poor ability to read emotions in other people is due to your inabilities because you have been not brought up in kind of calm and comfortable family environment. Now let's study work values. Work values are important because this is the kind of devotion which you put towards work. It is a process of self-improvement and a process of building a faith in life. A worker's personal conviction about what outcomes one should expect from the work and how one should behave at work is important. Because work is a kind of a professional arena in which your maturity in terms of behavior is important. The work values could be intrinsic values or extrinsic values. Now let's focus on intrinsic values. Intrinsic values is when you find work interesting. When you find your work challenging, it is you want to learn new things from your work, or you want to make important contributions to your work, or you want to bear the responsibility of taking up the challenges and giving a different shape to your work. It is being creative and giving an expression to your work. So if you have faith in work, this comes from your inbuilt desire. This comes from your heart. You have to put your soul in the your work environment, which can give you a kind of a confidence or which can give you an attitude to take up things in a different directions. Now, extrinsic values are, this could be attractive, and people, most of the people do work for extrinsic values, but these are not so important because maybe at one level of life, when you study the Maslow's theory, when you reach a very high level, then these values don't have so much importance for the work. The extrinsic values could be high pay, your job security, job benefits, the status, the kind of social contacts, the time, the amount of time which you spend with your family, the time for your hobbies and all. These are the extrinsic values which generally people look from the work. But these values are not so important because once you have achieved a kind of a level where you want self-actualization, then the intrinsic needs become important because they are the dominant part of your personality which give you a kind of a expression in terms of your behavior. Now, work values are basically shaped by work attitudes. What are work attitudes? It is a collection of feelings, beliefs and thoughts about how to behave with the people who are connected to you in the work. The attitudes could be more specific and it should be long lasting for your business. This could result into a job satisfaction or a kind of commitment which you have for the organization. Now, what is job satisfaction? The job satisfaction is designed by your work value. It is a collection of feelings and beliefs that people have about their current jobs. Maybe a job which gives you satisfaction, that same job will not give satisfaction to the other person. An organizational commitment is a kind of a collective feelings for the organization to be committed and take the organization as your own kind of a family or as a kind of your own environment. Now, the basic attitude of the work is work values is also affected by the affective, the cognitive and the behavioral aspects of the entrepreneur. The work moods are also important. What are work moods? These are the shapes and the kind of feelings which people have about their work. This is a kind of a transitory feelings which people pass through when they do their work. It can be generally categorized as positive or negative. There could be some situations in life where you feel positively about the work, and there could be some situations when you have a harassment, you feel negatively about your work. But most of the time, the work moods are determined by your own personality. It is the situation and it is circumstances outside the work. See, your personality as an individual is important because it is the way you perceive the work is important. Second, the work situation is a more comfortable and a more kind of a challenging and a motivating environment will put you at a better shape. But the environment outside you also influences the work. This could be your family problems, or this could be some kind of external environmental harassment which can depress your personality. And this depression is also reflected in the job which you are taking up in the organization. So, you know, it is very necessary that you balance with your values. Now, I'll show you in this diagram, which is shaped by the work values, the work attitudes, and the work moods. In this, you have three modules. These are connected by arrows. Now, if the work values are stable and the work attitudes are very moderate and the work moods are not changing very fast, then they will give you a kind of a stronger relationships. The stronger relationships are shown by the lighter lines, and the darker lines shows that there is a weaker relationship. Any imbalance in these three variables, whether they are variables in terms of values, attitudes, or moods, they change the total perception towards the job changes. Now, when you have studied the work values, what could be the advice to the businessman, how they can influence and shape the business? Don't try to assume that whatever perception you have, the same perception your employees and the other people will have. So try to realize and make an attempt that people feel comfortable at workplaces. Make the work environment more congenial and more attractive so as to promote people. Now, when you talk about job satisfaction and work values, the personality, work situation, the social influence, and the kind of values, both are important, or all these aspects have an interplay or a kind of an impact in terms of different intensities. And then we have the kind of resultant or the impact on the job satisfaction. Now, what is job satisfaction? It is the level of positivity or the level of challenge which you face in the job. Four theories of job satisfaction are: first is the facet model, second Herzberg's motivational hygiene theory, third is the discrepancy model, fourth is the steady state theory. Now let's see what is the facet model of job satisfaction. This focuses on the situation. Situations are important because every work is divided into kind of facets. Facets are the phases, and each facet or phase will utilize the ability of the employee. Now, the amount of ability used up in each phase gives a level of satisfaction to the employee. Now, if you are more matured and you are putting up the wholeheartedness in your work, then you could be more satisfied. And if you are highly qualified, but your work is not giving you that kind of commitment to use your ability, you may be dissatisfied. Then is the Herzberg's motivation hygiene theory. He says there are two factors. First is the motivating factors, and then you have the hygiene factors. The motivating factors could be the interesting work, the autonomy, the freedom, the kind of challenges, the creativity and expressions which you get from your work. The hygiene factors could be the environmental conditions, in which the physical conditions related to the lightning or the availability of bathrooms or the other air conditioning facilities which are available in the organization. Now, if the hygiene factors are not there, genuinely people will not be satisfied. But it is there. If the hygiene facilities are available, it is not that these facilities would motivate people to do work. So hygiene factors are important to take up the job in the organization, but people are only satisfied with the job when they have the motivating factors. Now, when you talk about satisfaction and dissatisfaction about the job, he said that both the states exist simultaneously. Sometimes, like, the employee will be satisfied with the job, and sometimes he will not be satisfied with the job. Here in this diagram, I've shown you the dissatisfaction with the job in terms of the hygiene factors, and this dissatisfaction with the job in terms of the motivating factors. If both are, if available there in the organization, he passes through the different extremes. Now let's study discrepancy model. In this, the gap between what one expects and what one gets is important. If the gap is very high, you feel dissatisfied. Now, what will be the ideal job for a person? What one thinks that the job should be like? What one expects the job to be like? What one wants from the job? What one's former job was like? So these are the kind of the parameters which basically shape the kind of the job satisfaction level. If you're expecting very high from your job and you're not getting it, this gap will cause a kind of a dissatisfaction. Then is the steady state theory. This says each worker has a typical characteristic and a level of job satisfaction. He may take up a challenging job. He may take up jobs in different situations, but would satisfy and would adjust him to a level which gives him a kind of an optimum and a steady and a moderate satisfaction. Now, in this diagram, again, we have shown you this is a kind of level of equilibrium or a level of equilibrium in the job satisfaction status. Events that increase job satisfaction and events that decrease job satisfaction, both the parameters are shown. Here we see if you get a promotion or a salary increase, you are happy. You get a bigger office with a window, you are happy. You win the monthly sales contest, you are happy. Now the events which decrease your job satisfaction would be your latest proposal is rejected, your request for a new desk is refused. So you know these situations simultaneously put up you in a level of ups and highs and lows and highs. But there would be an equilibrium status where you adjust yourself in terms of work values or in terms of job satisfaction. Now to the advice the managers or the businessman can have from this diagram or from these theories, we can say that people have to realize what they want from the job, try to provide those parameters, try to make newcomers comfortable, build up a team with people who have got a faith and a positive thinking towards the organization. And if you recognize the individual differences and determine job or the levels of skills according to their needs, you will be more successful as a businessman. Now the potential consequences which are the resultant of these kinds of satisfaction and the commitment is reflected in terms of performance, in terms of absenteeism or in terms of turnovers. Now when the performance is low, that means the employees are not genuinely satisfied in the organization, and if there is absenteeism, it also reflects a bad character for the organization. And if the turnover or the basic productivity of the organization is low, we can conclude that there is dissatisfaction in the organization. Now, determinants for these could be many. It is the ability of the organization not to provide a good salary or not to provide a kind of environment which is required. So if you try to build up these levels, you could have a kind of a potential consequences of positivity. These consequences could be organizational citizenship behavior and the worker well-being. Now, what is organizational citizenship behavior? This is the satisfied workers who are more likely to engage this behavior in the organization than the dissatisfied workers. This is the behavior above and beyond the call of duty. This is nonetheless necessary for the organization's survival and effectiveness. This means that beyond duty, you have more commitment for the organization. You have to work it for him as it is a family for you. It is your own recognition. It is your subordination of individual interest in the interest of the organization. Now, worker well-being is important because satisfied workers are a kind of assets for the companies or for the organizations. If the worker is happy, he is healthy and he is prosperous, he will give same thing and same level of feelings to the organization. The advice to the managers is important. You have to build up these feelings. You have to build a kind of a commitment in the employees so that they consider the business and the organization as their family businesses. Try to manage this absenteeism or the level of dissatisfaction in the company and try to build a commitment in the people. Now, commitment could be effective commitment or a continuous commitment. Effective commitment comes when the workers are happy to be the members of the organization and they consider it as a family. They identify their status and their brand recognition with the recognition of the organization. But the continuous commitment exists when the people who want to leave the organization, they have to pay very high for it. I mean, if you want to leave this job, you will be at a stage where you are losing a salary or you're losing a promotion. So they are not in a stage to leave the organization. They are continuing in the organization, but this kind of commitment is genuinely out of necessity. It is not out of happiness. Advice to the managers and to the businessmen is try to build up social responsibilities in the organization. Try to be conscious about the organization's brand recognition. Try to give the empowerment feelings and be socially and environmentally consciousness. This kind of consciousness will build up a kind of a feeling of faith and trust in the employees. Now, perception is important. Seeing is believing. I wouldn't have seen it if I wouldn't have believed it. Success is an attitude and a perception. I have people who have great successes in life. Let's see what are their perception. Stephen Covey: primary success comes from primary greatness, that is your character. If you are enjoying what you do, if you provide a service that benefits a person, then success is a byproduct. Deepak Chopra. 7 spirituals of success. Joy is an attitude. Then success is attitude, a passion. To succeed, you have to believe in something with such a passion that it becomes a reality. Anita Roderick. Success is an attitude built up in teamwork. If you can define success by how many points you score, I don't define success that way. It's for the team to define. Birley Bradley. Success is an attitude in form of motivation. Getting self-confidence is at the heart of success in every aspect of life. Jack Welch. Success is an attitude in terms of optimism. Successful people are optimists. They believe they can do and will do it. Marshall Goldsmith. Success is an attitude. Go for it.